Ben, thank you. I'd like to invite everybody who has a question to come up to the microphones and really have a discussion. And I'll throw out a challenge for the group, which maybe a little later I'll also ask you, which is, given how much public health works globally as well as domestically, how do we derive lessons from what from really the groundbreaking science that you've been doing to think about how to design the most impactful public health systems de novo without the constraints of history and perhaps conflict of interest? So I'd like to come back to that and give people time to think about it, because it's part of our responsibility as a school of public health to lead on that thinking. And we have two questions to start with, and I'll invite other people to come up to the microphones as well. Dr. Greenberg?
Thank you for the talk. Going back to one of your earlier slides, you listed some of the upstream drivers, and you didn't mention politics. There was yet another disheartening editorial in the Times today that made the argument, looking out at the political spectrum, that the Accountable Care Act is looked upon as a wealth transfer mechanism, which any national health service must be. But the interpretation was that they are getting resources that we earned. That's the political takeaway, and that's very hard to overcome. So how does public health deal with that political reality in terms of making its argument that ultimately, with this, quote, distribution of wealth, everybody would win?
Excellent question. I didn't give enough attention to the political dynamics in this work, and it's certainly you know, baked right into what to public health services and
sort of
how they
centered
operate
in Kentucky right now.
Absolutely, yeah, we're ground zero for some of this work in Kentucky. You know, I think part of the solution involves doing more of the work that can help us document the positive health and economic spillover effects that result from these kind of policies, that from resources invested and from time and attention invested in public health systems. If we can increasingly show the value streams that flow, both the health that flows from public health delivery systems, as well as the economic benefits that flow from those investments, and show how they flow over time and how they're distributed, the distributional effects of these activities, I think that helps to counteract some of the adverse and oppositional political dynamics surrounding these issues. I also think that's another reason to think carefully about governance and decision-making structures, how we build those structures into public health delivery systems, really at all levels of our system, national, state, and local. Having transparent decision-making structures and governance structures and having accountability mechanisms in place can also help to mitigate some of that distrust of what we do in public health, and particularly the governmental roles in public health. Those are a few thoughts. I know probably not satisfying, but critical that we make some progress on that front.
Dr. Baer?
Yeah. First, thank you for your very far-reaching analysis of the situation. I want to raise a question about the fundamental organizing frame of your analysis, however, and that is, you refer to public health delivery systems, obviously borrowing on the notion of medical care delivery systems, and the question is really whether public health as population health is best thought of as the consequence of a delivery system that is doing something, having doctors or nurses or healthcare workers, or whether it really goes back to the first slide you showed, which showed the US way, way, way off. And that way, way, way off has most typically been understood as a consequence of the fact that we have become increasingly a social unequal society, that, as you said, inequality at this point is probably at the greatest point in maybe close to 100 years. And that in the absence of any challenge to that fundamental organization of resources in the United States, everything we do in public health, important as it may be, will be of limited consequences in terms of making us look more like those places that do better. And finally, it seems to me that do you want to think of things like taxes that raise the price of cigarettes as a delivery system, or as a public policy that transforms the universe of smoking, or Berkeley's recent increase of a tax on sugar drinks, or the failed effort at portion size in New York? Those aren't delivery systems. Those are matters of public policy. And so the question is, this isn't to minimize what public health does when it does something like vaccinations, but there's much about public health, it seems to me, that would be hard to call a delivery system.
Fair point, and I absolutely. I think you know, we use the delivery system kind of metaphor in thinking about public health to really to help us get a handle empirically on the institutions that are actually supporting public health activity. Even you know, you could even think about even for a policy mechanism, you've got to have implementation capacity, and that at least part of that implementation capacity exists within the institutions that you know that have authority, responsibility, and resources to implement. So, and that's that. It is in some ways taking a medical model when we talk about delivery systems and trying to you know yet again trying to apply a medical model of public health. But the way that we use it is more as a organizing framework for helping us get a handle empirically on the institutions that are involved in supporting public health activity, whether that's program implementation or policy development enforcement activities. And a way of thinking about those institutional connections to public health work of the actors involved, but very fair point.
Dr. Galea?
Sandra Galea, epidemiology. Thank you for your talk. Is this on? Yes, it's on. I had a question for you about cities. So our last grand rounds, we had Bruce Katz from Brookings talking about cities, the Metropolitan Revolution, and I have the privilege of sitting on the New York City's health board, and where New York City areas is atypical. But separate and apart from the fact that it's atypical, it is modal across the country that cities are concentrating people. They frankly have a disproportionate number of people, and in the context of public health systems that are frequently county-based or state-based, cities get much less attention than they probably should. So I was wondering if I could ask your thoughts on that, and whether you see opportunities for cities, even those that do not have the kind of strong municipal health department that New York City does, to exercise sway on improving the health of the populations that are their responsibility.
I think that's an excellent point. I think absolutely. That's another you know element of our public health system writ large that is at play in terms of how we organize public health in cities. Particularly our largest cities, is very different from other places around the country. In the work that we've done, we have New York City's and Chicago's and Los Angeles's included in our delivery system typology, along with these small and rural systems as well. And certainly, certainly some of our strongest systems, some of our more robust and integrated systems are these city organized systems. Can we learn from how public health is operationalized in these city-based public health arenas? Absolutely. And I think in particular, work that I didn't go into much today, looking at, again, the role of decision governance and decision-making mechanisms, those mechanisms tend to be strongest in some of these large urban public, city-based public health strategies, you know, like the Board of Health that you sit on. And that has a significant effect on the work that's done.
Quickly before I sit down, you didn't cover your slides about something I was going to ask you, which is the role of scientific enterprise. Can you just give us 30 seconds on the role? I just would hate to leave without hearing your thoughts on that.
Yeah, thank you. I had a couple slides on that. I skipped through at the end as I was running long. I think the scientific enterprise is critical here. If we're going to learn from the variation that we see in public health across the country, if we're going to learn from the 1,001 natural experiments that are now playing out under the ACA as public health agencies renegotiate their roles and responsibilities with other actors, we got to be able to put a research design around all of that messy variation and change. And that is that's part of our responsibility as a scientific enterprise, and especially as academic public health institutions. It's messy work. It's fuzzy work. It requires adopting some new paradigms. It requires mixed methods. It requires interdisciplinary work, and it requires us to get a lot more applied with our thinking and our methodology. But I think we've got a major role to play in learning from the system change that's underway right now.
Thank you. Please introduce yourself.
Sure, my name is Navi Dardashi. I'm a management student in the Health Policy and Management Department here, and I graduate in May. And you've definitely done a good job of demonstrating the value of public health spending, and particularly in demonstrating where public health spending goes a long way. So in places where there is a great need and where there's already existing infrastructure. But I would like to know more about what public health should be spending on. So specifically, what kinds of investments have been particularly successful in showing a high return?
This is a great question, and this is an area where we've got a growing number of studies looking at these issues, but historically, public health has not been good at producing this kind of evidence. And it's the case that it's not just about how much we're spending, but it's how we're allocating, what we're investing public health resources in, that plays a role in the major role in how much health we produce. The challenge with answering that question is there's not a global answer to it. It's likely we know that health risks and needs vary community to community, and that's historically the great strength of public health, is it can customize and adapt to needs and risks and values and preferences that are found in the populations being served. And so where you should spend your next dollar in New York City is going to be different from where you should spend it in Hazard County, Kentucky. And so that makes for a more complicated empirical task of answering those questions. I think it can be done. We're trying to build capacity. Some of the work that we're doing in developing better metrics and better systems for tracking financial flows, for example, in the public health system, we're doing that with an eye toward being able to look more at a more granular level at allocation decisions and connect those into health and economic outcomes. That kind of work, it's possible to do. We know how to do it. We have methods. We can generate the data, and we just need more of it done, because the answer is going to vary as we look across the country.
Thank you.
If I can add, I'm one other response to your question is that I'm very proud that, complementing Dr. May's work, this school's investment in the creation of the GRAPH program is really investing in creating the analytics methods and findings to understand how to customize public health systems to the health needs of a given community, and how to design to optimize the return on investment in terms of health. So I think there's a lot of very exciting work that's going to be forthcoming from this school over the next few years to provide scientific leadership and those answers.
And I would fully echo that. I was really bowled over by hearing about that initiative today, and I think that's exactly what academic public health enterprises should be doing to answer these kind of questions. So very impressive work.
Please introduce yourself.
Hi, thanks for being here. My name is Jordan Mueller. I am a first-year MPH student in the Department of Socio-Medical Science, and I really appreciate you being here tonight, so thank you. I have a question that's going to kind of draw off of Dr. Galea's question about scientific enterprise and Dr. Baer's question about public health constantly modeling itself after medicine when it might have more to do with politics and society. And I'm going to phone a friend, Professor Sparer. We just took a test in health policy like 3 hours ago. And part of that test and part of that class that was extremely rewarding, especially coming right into this lecture that you gave, the public health fund that's part of the ACA, if I'm not mistaken, has already been dipped into? Yes? Yeah.
Multiple times.
Right. How do we, medical research is exciting and it's tangible. It results in products and procedures that people can consume and people can sell. Public health research often results in telling people what they can't consume and what they can't sell. How do we justify and shore up the limited funds that we do have when we don't enter the private market as frequently as the as medical companies, pharmaceutical companies, and biotechnology companies do?
Yeah, this is a fundamental challenge, and it gets at the heart of why our health system is skewed toward investments in therapeutics rather than prevention, and it gets to why our health research enterprise at NIH and everywhere else is also skewed toward that discovery of, you know, the therapeutics, the things that are going to have a market, as opposed to prevention and public health. There's not a magic bullet to kind of reorient that system, but I think our role as an academic enterprise and again, producing more evidence about the value of investments, current and potential value of the what public health systems can produce is going to be needs to be a big part of that. Even building at that evidence base just provides more opportunity and more empirical evidence to shape decision making about. About those issues, and I think also back to building in governance and decision making structures that can get more stakeholders to the table, give them more of a voice in these resource allocation decisions. Boards of health, state and local boards of health are making these decisions, so opening up those decision making structures and shining some light on decision making structures may also be helpful over time.
Thank you.
Our last question, and then I'll invite everybody to join us outside for a reception. Dr. Finkelstein.
Hi, I'm Ruth Finkelstein, the Columbia Aging Center. I was noticing that we might have who's making the investment and who's reaping the savings problem in public health. I was looking carefully at your slides about savings to Medicare. And noticing that the relationship between the investments and the savings there are somewhat modest. And furthermore, that the diseases of adults and older adults, they're more modest still. The biggest savings by investments are in infant mortality, not necessarily coincidental that those are state investments and then state costs. These are, you know, there's not much federal investment and then federal savings. And I wonder about the relationship between that as a political and policy, between that as a political and policy problem.
Yeah, no, you're right on target. This is the political economy problem in public health. And my gut is that's certainly at the heart of some of the, you know, the allocation patterns that we see here. I still think there are some mechanisms for helping to break that down. And the Arkansas innovation model I mentioned just briefly, as part of their Arkansas's state innovation model funded through CMS, they've actually negotiated with CMS a shared savings mechanism that allows some of the shared savings generated to Medicare to flow back to the state to help support those community health workers being employed in the public health system that's doing the connection. So there's more openness right now in the current policy environment for building in those kind of novel mechanisms. If we've got a little bit of proof of concept evidence, like we had with a 3-county pilot, and if we've got, stakeholders that can help shape those decisions. So it's a tough nut to crack, but I think there are some pathways forward.
I'll just conclude by saying thank you both for a great presentation and for demonstrating the value of science and really opening up a whole new field of inquiry, which is so critical to understand how to how to really develop 21st century public health systems that are intended to optimize the health of populations. This is an ongoing conversation for us, and we will be drawing lessons from what you have just shared with us all year and beyond. Thank you. Please join us outside for reception.
Thank you.